Now 7 o'clock, and I would like to open this May 14th, 2018 school board meeting. I'll call the order, and let it be shown that there is a quorum with the absence of Mr. Sansbury and Veronica Johnson. We'll start off with Victor Galvan giving the pledge, and David Rector leading us in the invocation. Please stand.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag.
I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Heavenly Father, it's again that you come. We come as your humble servants. We come thanking you for just watching over each and every one of us, and bring us back to this place one more time. Father, we thank you for the success of our students that they have had for this year, and pray that you'll continue your blessings upon them. And then, oh God, we come ask blessings upon this meeting this evening. Pray that you just touch the board members, and let this meeting go the way that you would have it to go. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
The next item on the agenda is recognition. APHS track state qualifiers are being recognized by Mr. Kemp.
Good evening. Wanted to recognize our two state qualifiers who have now finished their competition. They competed this past Saturday. First up, we have Matthew Butler. Please stand, please. Matthew Butler qualified in state track in the shot put. He was the area champion, the regional champion, and placed fourth in the shot put at state. And he was just a quarter inch off from being on the podium. Great job, man. Next we have Christian Chavez. Come on up. Christian qualified to stay in the 100, the 400, and the shot put. He started off his day in shot put and PR'd and received fifth place in state in the shot put. Then he went on to race in the 100 meters to finish in fourth place. And then he ended his evening, because it was pretty late at that point, about 7:30, 7:45. He finished fifth place in the 400. And very proud of what they've done. So
let's give them a round of applause.
Agenda is recognizing the Panthers of the Month and the Employees of the Month of April. Patricia Branch will read the monologues, and John Olenex will assist Mr. Kemp in reading the students and teachers.
Fall Early Childhood has selected Pascual Dominguez as their April Panther of the Month.
He is the son of Jesse and Trillian Dominguez. He is a kindergartner at Glock Early Childhood. He has an older brother, Cruz, and a younger sister, Lulu. In his spare time, he enjoys playing on his Wii and playing with his dogs, Momo and Dream George. He likes school because he gets to learn lots of different things. When he grows up, he wants to be a police officer. He was selected as Panther of the Month because he's a dedicated student. He is respectful and a good friend to others, as well as a big helper to his teacher, other teachers, and his classmates. Glock Early Childhood is proud to have Pascual Dominguez as their Panther of the Month.
If everyone that comes up can just stay up here for a group picture, we'd appreciate it.
Heber Elementary has selected Emily Carlos Morales as their April Panther of the Month. Emily's the daughter of Miguel and Claudia Carlos Morales. She's a third grader at Heber Elementary. In her spare time, she enjoys helping her mom with chores like laundry and washing dishes. I need to take her on the train. She also enjoys playing kickball and soccer with her siblings. Emily likes school because she loves learning. Her favorite subjects are math and reading. She would like to be a doctor for children when she grows up. Emily was selected as Panther of the Month because she is a hard worker, always pleasant, and always willing to help others. Heber Elementary is proud to have Emily Carlos Morales as her Panther of the Month. Charlie Marshall Elementary School has selected Louis Ramirez as their April Panther of the Month. Louis is a fourth grader at CNES. He is the son of Rolando Aguilar and Sylvia Briones. He has one sister named Samantha, one older sister named Andrea, and one older brother named Jose. He has three dogs named Milan, Snowball, and Tonka. Louis's favorite hobby is playing outside with his dogs, playing video games, and sometimes he enjoys coloring. His favorite color is blue, and his favorite subject in school is math. When he grows up, he wants to be a roofer and in time to buy his own ranch. Louis was selected as Panther of the Month because he's always respectful and always puts others first. We are very proud of his hard work and dedication. Please join us in congratulating Louis Ramirez. He is one of the many bright stars we have at Charlie Marshall Elementary School. A.C. Blount Middle School has selected Clarissa Hinojosa as her April Panther of the Month. Clarissa is an eighth grader at A.C. Blount Middle School. She is the daughter of Oscar and Lisa Hinojosa. She has one brother named Stevie and one sister named Alyssa. Clarissa has three dogs, but her dog Diego is her favorite. She enjoys learning about history, which is her favorite subject in school. In her spare time, she likes to hang out with friends, draw, and listen to music. She's very skilled at drawing, especially Disney characters. Her dream job, would be to work with Disney, using her skills as an artist. Clarissa was selected as Panther of the Month because not only is she a dedicated student, she sets a good example to others on how to be caring and kind. She was nominated by her teachers because she works hard in class and is a good friend to her classmates. A.C. Blount Middle School is proud to have Clarissa Hinojosa as their Panther of the Month. Last but not least, is our Mitchell Pass High School has selected Avery Brindrett for their April Panther of the Month. Avery is a freshman at APHS. She is the daughter of Bob and Alicia Brindrett. In her spare time, she enjoys band, playing the ukulele, painting, and spending time with family and friends. She loves taking care of her dogs, Holly and Trixie, and her cat, Tippy. Her favorite subject in school is English. She is considering going to college to become a pediatrician or a journalist. She was selected as Panther of the Month because she is a dedicated student. She's always polite and displays good citizenship, a willingness to help in any situation, and kindness to others. Aransas Pass High School is proud that Avery Brindrett as her Panther of the Month.
All right.
Robin Vogel. You can't leave yet. Keeper Employee of the Month is Robin Vogel. Charlie Marshall Employee of the Month is Amy Abrego. A.C. Blunt Employee of the Month, Mary Steed. And last but not least, from the APHS High School, MCAS High School, is Linda Hamilton. Congratulations.
Next information item is the board welcomes the public and its comments, and that is by sign in only. So if anyone signed in, there hasn't been anyone signed in. So at this time, we're going to continue with the meeting. If parents and children would like to leave and continue your evening, you're welcome to leave now, or you're welcome to stay. Thank you all very much. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. The next item on the agenda is an information item, accounts payable reports. The accounts payable report of April 2018 is included in our packet. We did all have time to discuss or review as of Friday. Is there any discussion regarding these numbers, this information? No discussion. Carrying on. The next information item is the budget status and investment report from April 2018, as also included in our board book as of Friday. Any discussion? Item is a tax collection report from April 2018. We had time to review all this. Is there any discussion? The information in front of us is regarding attendance. This is the attendance report for the fifth 6 weeks of the school year provided to us on Friday. Is there any discussion?
I'd just like to congratulate the Keebler Elementary School. They had a 96.01% attendance. continue to attend. That's the highest, I think, we've had quite a while, so I just want to tell them to be proud of them. The rest of the schools had adequate, above 90, or anywhere from 91 to 94 to 95%, so all of them are still kind of high, so I want to pass my congratulations and tell you that we're proud of you guys, the hard work you're doing to keep it to yourself.
The next item is information also, donations from the Hurricane Harvey. This report was requested last month for our review, and is there any questions or discussion?
I've got a couple of questions. I know there's been, I don't know about you guys, but I've had questions asked of the district employees, people in the community of what kind of donations we received. I just believe it's important that we're transparent in what we did receive. We've got a list here, a spreadsheet of all the donors that's listed by campus, and it also has dates that the thank you letters went out, so the board had asked. Breakdown on the donations to APISD, total was $236,937.20. That did not have a designation other than APISD, so they've been classified as a district donation. The high school had $7,050. The middle school, $61,946.17. And I had a question on this one. There's a line item of local lumber liquidators for $32,000 and then one for $24,000.
It was split. $32,000 came in directly to the district as it changed. But because we're not designated as a 501c3, there was $26,000 that had to be passed through ESC2 to us. And we got the $24,826 out of that. There's a fee or something associated with the electronic transfer.
Charlie Marshall had $3,000. Key Burger, $29,742.56. Falk Elementary, $12,494.35. The Athletic Department, $8,730. Band, $1,700. High School Counselors, $3,500. The Library was $86,696.50. And it looked like the bulk of that came from the Laura Bush Foundation grant, which was $70,000. Special Ed Department, $500. And then there's a classification of t-shirts for students district-wide, $4,611. So when you do the math, the donations to the district plus the donations to the different campuses total $456,909.74. So I guess my question, several questions, is how's the money going to be? There we go. I'm sure I had some conversations on this today because I had some questions. And then the money that's been designated to the campuses, at whose discretion is it? Is how that money spent? Does it go to the superintendent's office? Does the principal decide? What do we have systemically of how we're going to?
I think there's conversations between the staff and the principal to decide how they want to spend the money. At least that's the way it's been on several of the campuses when it's designated to them.
Also, we want to make sure that districts are on the campuses so they're using those funds. We're just not going to have parties for everybody.
Sure.
In essence, I just want to fit the rebuild on each campus along with the students.
Well, and one of the conversations that Sherwin and I had today is what we've gone through since August has been great. You know, from the first step of declaring an emergency and approving that we're going to pay our staff, you know, for the month of September and half of October. I mean, that's we didn't have any enrollment during that period, so right now the state hasn't made the designation whether they're going to reimburse us that money or not. So that money's could potentially come from our general fund balance. We hope that they're going to reimburse us for it, but guess the one thing that I want to say to staff is, I mean, it's one of the questions that have been asked to me, well, this money was donated to the district, why is it not being allocated to the different campuses? And I think the response to that, if I remember our conversation correctly, is we're not at the end of this disaster that we had yet. We've got multiple projects that we're funding from our bond, all the different projects that require extra money for us to expend and for us to stake out and be in a position to where we do have funds for unforeseen expenses. We have to be prudent with what we have, but at the same time, I believe it's important that the staff knows the money that was allocated to the campuses and what we had out there district-wide that's sitting there. We haven't made a final determination how that money's going to be expended, but your superintendent, your business manager are here to guide y'all through that. And we're here to help you guys do that also. Seems like it's a lot of money, but we're moving to $500,000 and $1 million here and there. I mean, it doesn't take long for the money to add up. So I just wanted, I think one of the things Ms. Johnson wanted to do was to make sure that we had transparency of everything that was given to us. I think it's public record. Anybody wants to see the donations, they can see central office and get a copy of this. It's interesting to see where the money came from all over the state.
And if you run across anyone, please thank them. Anyone on this list, it's a blessing and a godsend, as we all remember. But we needed it, we'll need it. Even if we don't know where to put it yet, things will come up. So,
and we're not through receiving donations. We got two more checks in today. One was from a public elementary school in Virginia, and another one was from Mansfield ISD here in Texas. Every day is a surprise.
Blessing. Again, thank you. Thank you, Cheryl, for keeping up with that. That's a big job. The next item is also information. It's contact and non-returning students after Hurricane Harvey. Information regarding the district's contact with families who do not return after Hurricane Harvey has been provided by the board for the board's review. It is broken down into campuses, and basically we had 90 students overall relocated and were displaced in the areas listed below. So 90 of them went, the majority of them went to Portland, Ingleside. Portland had 18, Ingleside had 15, and Corpus Christi in general had 19. There are specific towns here and there, but that's where the majority of the 90 people went. And then it breaks it down into the Falk Elementary had 8 that did not return. 10 students were not able to be located at all. And parents cited reasons for not returning included housing issues, employment, and not wanting to change schools in the year. W.A. Kieberger, 65, November 16th, students determined to have been displaced by Hurricane Harvey. Reasons for not returning included housing issues and homeschooling. All displaced Kieberger students were located. Enrolled in Texas schools was 65, 1 was homeschooled, and 8 returned to Kieberger. Charlie Marshall Elementary, of the 63 students that did not return after the storm, that the office staff was able to make contact with or receive records from the request of transfer. 3 had been able to return, 1 wants to return, but employment in the medical field is not available. 1 likes it where they're at in Tolosa Midway. 7 said they would but don't have a home. And 51 were there, they are because of whatever circumstances. They stay in where they're at because of the circumstances they had experienced due to Harvey, and contact couldn't be made. So the majority of Charlie Marshall's, they just couldn't reach the 51 students.
Well, they were reached but didn't give a specific
reason
as to
life
circumstances. I'd say housing was a lot.
Yeah. The number of Charlie Marshall students, the majority, 6 of those that didn't return went to GP, 9 went to CCISD, 10 went to Ingleside, 2 to Rockport, 1 to West Oso. AC Blunt Middle School, as of November, we have identified 21 students that had been displaced. Ms. Adami and Ms. Sheffield located 19 of those 21, either by phone or by receipt of record request. 10 of those were enrolled in out-of-state schools. 2 were being homeschooled, 1 has not been located, and the remaining 6 students have enrolled in districts in Texas. 2 of the 21 have returned to AC Blunt. And in Inside High School, there was 45 that had been identified non-returning. Non-returning students were contacted by the counseling department. Given reasons given were homeschooling, returning to school, to home country, enrolled in school outside of Texas, housing issues, and enrolling in other schools in Texas. Two students were not able to be contacted. 11 of them were identified as being displaced. 11 of them have returned to APIHS. A total of 96 students have left APIHS from August to present. And 78 of them are still enrolled in Texas schools. 5 of them are being homeschooled, and 9 of them went out of state. And special ed students, immediately following the Hurricane Harvey, they kept a handwritten list of students enrolled in other districts. As of April, they called every parent who told us they might return next year to see if their plans had changed. At this point, they've reached out to every parent at least once or several times. Some have been contacted 3 times. On April 26th, there were 55 special ed students that were enrolled in APISD on 6-2-2017 that did not return from 6-2-2017. So 55 as of last month. Approximately 1 to 3 parents have indicated that they might consider coming back, but did not have a place to live in the district. On the other hand, 33 special ed students who did not previously attend APISD, we received 33 new ones. So I'm reading. Yes. Okay. The net change of special education enrollment is 28, including dismissals. The number is aligned with the overall decrease in population after Hurricane Harvey. We originally lost approximately 300 students, roughly 10% special ed. On current enrollment, it's also representative of an overall population. As of now, we have accounted for every special ed student who is enrolled in APISD prior to the hurricane. And thank you all for this work. I know it's a lot to try to even contact and track these people. I know the transfer records help a lot to find out where they went. A little concerned about all the homeschooling students. Hopefully that's actually being made a program that they're actually following and getting some assistance with. It's not an easy task for those parents to take on homeschooling. The next item on the agenda, is there any questions or comments about that information? Okay, moving on then. Custom design of APHS library. Schematics of the layout and photos of the selected furniture for the library for APHS has been included for the board's information. Please note the photos of the furniture provided do not represent the chosen colors of those pieces. And I'm just looking, it holds about 40 people. Is that about what we're...
I guess the design set up for courses is always versatile. What you see here would be probably exactly the way the high school would set up their library. It would be a combination of books and technology, along with some specialized seating to assist kids in making more material, but also provide them with comfort.
Technology meaning how many computers are going in this?
It's going to vary on the size of the room. About 10. Computers can be mounted on the edge of the library where they're at now. The computer stations just kind of
took some bookshelves out and put some more shelving.
I have one question. The furniture expenditures that we approved last month, is that part of the insurance company?
And the librarians got to participate in this? Anyone have any questions?
The question was, when we approved the insurance expenditures last month, that's part of the insurance claim for the furniture.
I don't know if that was part of the furniture insurance claim.
That furniture claim from the bid, that was for basically for middle school, but for the library, it was.
Was it a library?
Yes.
There were two purposes.
There were two different bids that we
and they were both part of the claim.
Requested.
Thank you all for providing us with that information. The next item is information update on Marshall Company. A representative from Marshall Company will provide an update regarding the progress of a high school gymnasium. I'm sorry, sir, I did not have your name.
But Ellen Zosa.
Welcome.
Thank you for your interest.
Good evening. But Ellen Zosa with Marshall Company. Glad to give you an update on our project, the gymnasium addition. We have been school meeting currently and consistently with Superintendent Camp, Mr. Ochoa, Architect Todd Brendel, and Mar Womack. And then we are currently in the steel erection stage of the project. We have a critical area of the higher roof still working on and trying to make sure everything's attached as sufficient as it needs to be in design and accurately, all plumb and square. As soon as we can get that high roof done, framed it, we'll start decking and stabilize it even further. We'd like to get started, we want to get started on actually some exterior walls, block walls. This will be a CMU building. We'll start those as early as by the end of the week, if not early, and early next week. Along with that, since these are block walls, you'll have electrical, mechanical, plumbing going in with the walls, inside the walls. So those crews can get started. We have some electrical raceways that have been ongoing with the deck that we have installed, steel deck for the low roof. And our acoustical deck, structural deck, is on site and it's ready to go since the high roof is going to start attaching. And once the decks are in, then we can start our roof installations, along with the walls going on down below. We have a sanitary sewer and a site work on the site, sanitary sewer continuing. We had some done last week, and we'll have some items that will have to be done as soon as school is out. Connection across McMullen to the main for the sanitary sewer, road crossing. That's going to go through the city permitting for that. And then we also have a transformer that's going to be replaced by AED so that we can bring this building online to the existing high school service. That's where we're at right now. Do you have any questions?
Are you fairly about on the schedule right now?
We'd like to be a little further ahead. We still plan on finishing on our date, but we'll have to make some headway here after our roofs, after our structural is done, and get to going with our block walls and the rest of our structure. I think Brendan's going to show you some colors on our exterior masonry to approve. And once that's approved, we'd like to release that order and have it on site ready to go.
I've got a question. I don't know if you can answer this or not. It was asked of me on the gym floor. I know at one point when we were looking at saving some money, we went from a grade A gym to a grade B on the gym floor. I think there wasn't much of a integrity issue or difference on the two. But one of the questions is that in a parquet? That's not a question.
There was a
parquet floor.
There was. I'm glad you brought that up. But there are some. Before we released the order for the flooring, then there was some introduction from the coaches on the flooring specifically, like you said, and they're looking at trying to possibly change it back to for value engineering. It was changed to another, to a less costlier floor, although it's still a good floor. It's just that he's trying to see if we can get maybe the parquet back in.
So the parquet was the upgrade one that we eliminated?
Yes, sir. And there's some, he's given us, Coach has given us some, Coach A has given us some striking direction on some of the striking that he wants to have. Actually, there's possibly going to be some future revisions as far as where the seats, how many seats are on which side. Some last minute, but we need to get them finalized as soon as possible so we can get our order.
The revisions that were made were originally board approved. So many revisions that you guys come up with need to come back to the board to make sure that it's in the plan that we have for the gym. It's great that you guys are having conversations.
I think Mr. Beverly is going to make sure y'all oversee that too.
less striping. I'm assuming, Coach Knotsman, that Ms. Springs is involved in that to make sure the courts are regulation for volleyball as well. So you're saying that, you're saying it was...
We did have a meeting with all the two coaches and the athletic director, yes. And they have several questions for us on that.
It's practice line, I mean, it's for practice line, double courts for volleyball, and then Coach Hayes brought up having practice lines for when they go both sides,
right,
three-point line, things like that. But everything is where we can do both, the set, where we can have two volleyball courts going, or we can have two practice basketball courts going, and on top of all the official game lines.
And I'm sorry to be redundant here, but on the parquet, there's no way we can get that gym floor that Coach Hayes is requesting in the grade B that we have?
We have a proposal that came from the supplier, and it's being discussed, I think, by Ms. Bradlin and Superintendent Kelly.
Make sure that they want to work out in that with them. I don't have any question. It's always price.
Thank you very much for your time. Appreciate you staying. The next item is an information item for the company of Don Kruger Construction Company. A representative from the company will provide us with an update on the status of the new elementary school project.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Grace Graves with Kruger Construction, project manager for this project. We'll go over what we've done last time since we've met here. We poured all seven slabs of our slab to finish completion of the first floor. We poured 80 total panels out of 84. We have four remaining. Those four will be poured as soon as the tilt walls that are on the concrete slab now get stood up to allow us to have room to pour those. We're probably right at 65% complete for the panels that have been set already. Our crane was scheduled for this morning, and it's going to be now Wednesday. And then once we set those, all those panels will go very quickly around the perimeter of the building, and it will be just four left. We've also demoed inside and outside of the existing gym. That's block walls and interior block walls that we had to take out. We're starting to install hangers and ductwork off the joists inside the new elementary school. We're installing joists and deck throughout the building. We're probably about 40% of that right now. When we get more of the tilt walls up, we will continue to fall back behind that and start installing joists and deck on them. The next month, we'll continue to set the tilt walls like we talked about. We'll start installing CME block on top of the existing gym, on the sides, insulation and CMU. We'll also start installing CME block walls inside the new school throughout the corridors. Our goal is to have the second floor of the school poured by the end of this month to allow us to start our roofer. We're going to start installing windows, and we will start our goal is our we're going to power spray the outside of the tilt walls right now, and that'll allow time to dry, and then we'll start to paint those if the colors get approved. I think Todd has that for you guys to look at today. So things are moving along a lot better now that we've had some dry and hot weather now. I think we're rolling right into summer very quickly. But we continue to strive forward and hopefully start a lot of trade on top of the steel erection getting complete and the tilt walls getting stood up. So I know you guys have seen some progress out there now. I know it didn't look like it before, but hopefully we can have all the tilt walls stood up here pretty quick and start all the interior joists and deck, and it'll allow us to start a bunch of trades after that. So anybody have any questions?
Information item is from Todd with Lamar Womack and Associates providing us us an update on the district's projects in general. Welcome, Todd.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here tonight. Kind of just want to go over a few items. The main things, we're having our construction meeting tomorrow, so a lot of this information that you've got is almost 2 weeks old, so they've kind of given you a pretty good update on where we are as far as construction-wise. I can answer any questions as far as, I know that one thing we need to do is to get the colors finalized. I think we selected a color pattern and such.
The brick, is that what you're...
Yes.
It's further down in the agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry, is that, well...
You're talking about...
I'm talking the exterior, the paint color, so we can move, yes, of the elementary school, so we can, is that later in the agenda?
The paint color.
Okay, well, that's okay. I mean, that we're,
Last.
Yeah, we approved it last.
Yeah, we had, there was a question, so we tried to clarify it.
We had several renditions.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we went with rendition D.
Okay, that's right, that's right.
Right, we did.
Okay.
But what we did is we had the actual colors painted on a panel on site, so you can kind of see the actual colors, because the rendering, you know, doesn't really, not too accurate, so I don't think they had a chance to look at those colors, but if not, I mean, we're going to proceed with those colors unless there's any objection to those.
They're more welcome to go check it out, to go drive by our job site trailer, check in with our superintendent, so I know you're, I think you can, so I think you can solve it till one today, I think. But it's there if you don't like the review as well.
It's a true purple. I mean, one of my concerns is maintenance and fading, and, you know, how often are we going to have to repaint that? And I know you guys don't have a crystal ball, but I'm just curious. I mean, and one of the reasons I ask is when I look at AC Blunt back here in the back, that was built approximately 85 to 89, 87, somewhere in there. And I don't know if it's just from a lack of maintenance, but you can tell on the brick where it's faded or whatever. I don't know if it's just a matter of water blasting or putting a solid on there to clean that up. I just want to know what we're going to have to do from a maintenance standpoint. If we actually put color on the panels, what are we looking at?
Well, I mean, maybe 5% of your panels are purple. I mean, so there's very little purple. It's only at the entries, basically at the entries to the building. So very little purple, but a lot of it's under shade. So, I mean, it's good Sherwin-Williams paint.
Isn't it made for tilt wall?
It's made for concrete and tilt wall exterior. So it's Luxon, like the top of the line concrete paint.
Well.
So I know there was it's not paint you go to the hardware store.
Right. I know there was a question about the tower that's in the rendition.
Right.
Whether that was going to be purple or not.
Right. And so that's what I brought. So, I mean, we have, and maybe I looked at it, in the superintendent's office, and y'all tell me, but we have a purple tower, we have a tan tower. So, I mean, that's, everything else is pretty well decided, and so that's a small piece of the puzzle. I thought it was going to be tan, and so not purple, and then there was some question on...
It's something we can visit with.
Yeah, and so that's not a major issue, no. And it is just paint, so...
What is the projected date of completion time?
I think we're looking at January, something like that. I mean, that's
our short goal for right now.
And we did receive, we did have meetings with the coaches, with the athletic director, and so we did have a pretty comprehensive meeting, and they had a lot of input. And so we're taking that information, which the court design and the wall painting design, and we're going to do some in-house design work with that, so we can get it to Marshall Company, so they can get it professionally done and sent back to you. But it kind of totally changed from what we originally had, and so it's got to go back to kind of and redesign that.
Do very many of the items incorporate a change order, or is it just?
It's just paint. I mean, the wall padding, we didn't have any graphics on it, so there'd probably be a charge for that. I mean, we don't know exactly what that number is, but we have a contingency. We haven't used much of it at this point. And then the bleachers, we're trying to balance out so you don't have more people on the visitor side than the home side, because we've got the stadium seating. You know, there's like 50 seats on the home side. So that changed the spacing a little bit. So we're trying to balance that, and we'll have that plan back to you. But I think we've got it figured out. We just need to get it finalized by the manufacturer so they can build it correctly. I really don't have anything to add, I mean, to what they've talked about today. I can answer questions or...
I mean, the only comment I would make to my board members is that we only get one time to do this. That deal's going to be standing there a long time. I'd like to make sure, and I know we've been as diligent as possible, make sure we get all the specs right. But as far as the aesthetics and Coach Moxman, I think you and I had a conversation about this. If there's not any major changes, and we have some supplemental money there, if there's anything aesthetically that we can do in there, the big logos or anything that dressed up, like I said, it's going to be there forever for us. I'm sure.
Brent, okay, he's pretty autistic. And he did a lot of hand drawings that he's gotten to them, or at least I thought they're hand drawings. But he's got graphics, and he's I think they're gonna be able to get you, and it's pretty good. I mean, from what just by his hand things, I think it's aesthetically it's going to be it's gonna pop.
How much money do we have available for change orders?
It was 30,000.
100,000.
30,000.
100,000?
30,000.
Todd, just the minutes of last meeting was that we agreed on the alternating purple and gold stadium seating on the home side, an additional row added to the home side. Are we on the same page there?
We're trying to add two rows to the home side.
Stadium seating?
No, just bench seating.
What's the rationale behind that?
Well, because if we don't, you're going to have 480 on visitor side and 300 and 400 on the home side. So you're going to have less on the home side.
We don't do that.
So we're trying to balance it, you know, and that's a little challenge, but I think we'll have it done.
I thought the challenge was adding one, so we're going to add two
that
side and still have walking room?
Yes, because we have a little extra space on the home side. And then what we're doing is, instead of doing 31 inch all the way up, we're trying to do 26 the last three rows. So we're gaining 15 inches. I mean, we're still gonna have at least 8 feet to the court. So it's not finalized until we get it from the manufacturer, but we know we have the player sitting on that side and the scorpion, and we have, so we need to have an aisle there. There's going to be quite a bit of space there. And we won't finalize it until the director gets to see it.
Okay.
So. And one last question. On the handicap, I may have asked this last thing. Have we designated handicap areas for the handicap? I've been into other gyms to where they're kind of put off to the side, or there's other gyms I've been into where they actually have a section where you can roll them back in there and their family can sit around. So have we taken that?
Yes, sir. The bleachers are set up for ADA wheelchairs, and so if they're not used, they can pull them out and have men's seats, and they push in, and then there's seats for them, and they're designed in the bleacher system. Yes.
Other questions? Thank you very much.
Okay.
Appreciate your time. The next item is also information, is potential upgrades to AC Blunt tennis courts. The information regarding design upgrade for the AC Blunt middle school tennis courts is provided for the board's review, and written by Derek King. This is just an information item, but in discussion with AC Blunt campus faculty and staff, the upgrades are suggested to have the surface of the courts cleaned and filled and sealed, basketball keys painted, 6 basketball goals installed, and 1 or more concrete ping pong tables, chess tables, shuffle boards, or other permanent recreational activities to be put into the basketball or tennis courts. But I think we asked that they do something with it or tear it down, one or the other. So you got creative from our last board meeting. It looks all cosmetic, more so than How expensive can that be? Can you get some quotes to see if, how much that would cost to resurface a clean fill and seal?
Well, just some comments from our junior advisory council, that the students in sixth grade say it's a prison over there, they're like in jail. They call it their jail, when they go in there, the sixth grade figures are in jail, they're all wired in, there's no way for them to get out.
And there's nothing to do.
That's part of the do, so.
We want the multi-use recreational facility.
Very good.
I got a question for you. I got a question for you. Are you gonna be working? If we do this, are you gonna work? Or you should be on the playground.
Shuffleboard.
I can put your office up.
I like playing checkers.
I think, I appreciate the feedback, I would only recommend you get some quotes. From, learning from Harvey, at least three, because they can go from one end to the podium to the other as far as number wise. And see what we can do with it. I like the creativity of it all personally. Is there any further comments? Okay, thank you very much. The next item on the agenda is information, scope of work, insurance claim, and damage loss report. Information regarding the scope of work, insurance claims, and damage loss has been provided to us by Cheryl. Thank you very much. And Belford on their updated. And you're pretty much aware of everything.
They're up to date.
Is there any questions regarding all of this information? There's still some pending work out there, and pretty much on every campus. I'm curious why, and I think I asked this last month, but I cannot remember, why the high school didn't get a roof?
I was asked to talk about this.
All those air conditioning units came off of it?
Right, that's still being negotiated with the insurance company right now. The first adjustment of the roof at the high school in Keyburger, they only did sections, they only approved to fix sections. We talked about that last time, and they came out a second time because we requested it with an engineer and with the roofing company expert, and they added a little more to each campus, but it's still not complete. So Mr. Kemp and I and Cheryl, we discussed this, and we think it's in the best interest of the district and these facilities to hire an expert to come in to help us see if we can we can get the roofs done. And Todd has offered us an expert. It's a thermal imaging company expert that does this kind of work. It's done work on projects with him, districts around here, and actually helped him in situations like this where they've proven, hey, there is damage, there's moisture here and there, but where they're saying there's not any damage, and it helped.
Didn't we have damage in the last rain in both facilities?
Well, we always...
Leaking and...
Right, well, I mean, these roofs have been, these are new, and this is all warranty work here that it leaks, but I'm talking about, you know, the high school. Right now, they just patched the high school. They just patched Keyburger, okay? And the patches are working to a point, but the areas that they didn't have to designate to be repaired is what the areas we want to get tested for this thermal imaging, and it does. I've got information from this expert. I've got the credentials, the company. If you guys are interested, I can get that sent to you so you can look at her. She actually sent me reports from the school. She did over at Skidmore Tynan and a school in San Antonio that are close to us. They do this work all over the nation.
And we present that to Belfort or to the insurance company to dispute the
when we can dispute it, right. And that's, I think we need to do that. We're just basically asking for your blessing to move forward with this.
I think the minutes from last month reflected we requested that.
Okay. So
it's already been requested.
Okay, so we found them, sir, and we're going to move forward then. Okay.
Well, this is an action. This is just an information. This right. is not an action. Do we have to approve the purpose?
We requested the information last month because we had the same information that was shared with us because they were wanting to do a patch job and in between the expansion joints when we were concerned right. of whether we were really getting a true assessment of the value or the damage because it's a gravel-based roof.
Right. Correct? That's correct.
So at that point, we thought it would be in our best interest to get a third party come out here and inspect it for us. And that was the direction that we gave the administration last week, so. I've got several questions today, if you don't mind. Bear with me, this is for you, Mr. Kent. Have we communicated to Belfour that all the remaining replacements or repairs must be completed by the beginning of the 2018 occupancy?
We have not been specific. Belfour still has a crew around working. Again, we have a particular day.
My position would be that we've been doing this since August. We have a remaining list of items that work that they, that needs to be completed. The Charlie Marshall repair of the bus stop canopy.
And I'm mistaken, I think that's an insurance concern. Those are the insurance company.
So that hasn't been approved yet?
It has not.
I'm a little.
Because I inquired on that, same insurance.
So on Belfour's update, as of May 9, 2018, Charlie Marshall opened item, repaired the school bus stop canopy. That was from them. Repair a water well.
That was the one, that's the one at the softball field, but that's been done.
I guess I'm confused. I'm confused to the point that the report shows that they owe us, they have uncompleted projects. I guess my question is, on their list, have you have copied this?
In front of the server, actually, yeah.
But on their list that they provided to us was uncompleted work, so I assume this was work that they had got approved and that we were waiting for them to get done this summer.
I inquired about the canopy, so I believe it's an insurance.
Okay.
Insurance total, that's why we can keep it. Keep me on other items like that where they're trying to get plans, guys that would be able to say.
God, the winds, how far could a canopy be? Obviously, they're.
Yeah, my point more is, I mean, we've had enough time. I think we need to start next year at a point where we have minimum amount of distractions and interruptions to our school day for our principals and our students.
But I can talk to you.
On the, and Cheryl, and you know, you guys correct me if I'm wrong, I just want to make sure I'm on the same page with you guys. On the Falk campus, my understanding that the roof was patched, like Mr. Lefeu said, just for us to get through the school year because of the demolition. So with that said, there should be some savings from the total amount of the cash value of that roof versus what we pay for the patch job. So at some point, I guess when Lance gets the final report, I would like to know what that dollar amount is that we're going to be able to save there.
But we're still looking into replacing it.
Falk's going to be demolished.
Falk's going to be demolished.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's
you're talking about, you're talking, I think you're talking about Keyburger.
It was right. Keyburger, I'm sorry.
On the high school, we're talking about the dispute that we have going on with the insurance company. If we have to use bond money to complete the total repair, how much are we looking at? And I think there was a prior report, Ms. Andrew, that you provided last month. It was what, around $600,000 for both of them, for Keyburger and the high school. Does that sound right?
The difference at the high school was around $295,000 from what the insurance was going to pay, and what the roofing company gave us just a quick estimate of what a new roof might cost, and there was about $100,000 difference between insurance and what they thought a new roof at Keyburger would cost. So it was right at $100,000.
On the track, no. But when you and I visited, there were several sections that had been damaged, and we had a company come in and patch them.
Mm-hmm.
That was just to get us through the track season, correct?
At that time, but
at that time,
yeah, right. But since the resurfacing has been done, it's complete.
I understand, but I want to make sure that we're clear about is, what is part of the insurance? What part is the district paying for? In my mind thought, and the way I rationalize it to myself, the damage that was done to the track was as a consequence of the hurricane. Something was flying around, something was hitting, something was causing all these cracks all over the place. So my question is the total resurface going to be on the district's side, or is it part of the insurance claim?
Part of it's an insurance claim. I don't have the amount in my head right now. I'd have to get Cheryl, but there was, they did adjust the damage of the track, a portion of it, where it's here, it's water, we just pay for his patch jobs, and we went ahead and resurfaced the whole thing, so we'll have to find that out.
We just got the invoice for the resurface, and that is, I'm going to be forwarding that to our insurance claim. I'm going to report it as a claim, because if the company that Belford had hired to repatch the surface, if they had been allowed to, they would have come in and done the respray and the lining, putting the lines down. But we needed to bid that portion out, and when we did bid it, the company that did the patch job was not the low bid. So there's that disconnect. All of it is still an insurance issue.
Two different people doing it.
It should be. So I'm going to submit that to our insurance company and say, you did pay for the patch, but this is the rest of the job.
And they're probably going to just depreciate it, because we were up for needing to resurface it anyway. So
yes,
even if we get a depreciated rate, that's better than nothing.
My argument to the insurance person, you put the name, sorry, you just mentioned.
I'm
doing the claim to Lance. My argument to Lance is, if you guys had done the patch jobs, the patch job would not have matched the remaining surface of the track. You had discoloration. Consequently, in order to have a like match and quality, you should have resurfaced the whole track. Otherwise, we would have had a track with different spots all over the place.
Absolutely.
It didn't match. So I think we have an argument for them to pay for the total resurface on it, like we just talked about earlier. Mr. Cho's questions for you on the athletic building between the field house and the actual athletic building. There's a panel that's been damaged. I don't know if the canopy came off and hit it. As you walk between the weight room and Coach Knotsman's office, mm-hmm. you can see where it is. That part of the claim, is that going
that's
to be addressed to?
Yes, it's just one of those parts of those canopies that are being held up right now. I really haven't gotten a definite answer from the insurance company or Belfort why they're delaying that. That's really not part of the roof of the main building.
Right. So. And then on the alternative school, Mr. Kemp, at some point those buildings are going to go away.
We're working with Scott Sporsman now to extend that contract, hopefully on a month-to-month basis, until we can get the elementary school built, so we can transfer the kids from Keeber to the new elementary, and then possibly use Keeber as our newest facility for the elementary.
So right now the administrative plan is not to go back into the old Walton level. It's got asbestos problems.
We still want to do that. It has been abated for asbestos, but we need the subform replacement, but we're not sure if that's going to take care of the cement for the older. We have talked about putting in essential air, of course a deep clean, and maybe that would take care of the older. For right now, until we get the asbestos away, we're looking to keep it as soon as we can.
So you guys are still working on a plan for the 18-19 school year?
That's correct, yes. Yes. I take the Scott Sportsman as the people who are going to be the court.
I don't want to belabor a point. In visiting the show earlier, one of my concerns is as we move down the road, 3 or 4 years down, I think the board was really diligent in making sure that we had a decent fund balance to pay for an emergency like this. But as we've had to tap into it, salaries, having to use the $1 million for the professional service, that was kind of a wash because we had that in a designated fund, correct? But we've had to allocate for the overbid for the salaries. When you're talking to the tunes of $1.3 and $500,000, your fund balance goes real quick. So as we're moving forward in the future for $7,000 expenditures, it's going to have to cut out of fund balance. We need to be very cautious in what we're doing, making sure that we're capitalizing on all our dollars, like the track, if we can get that money back, or like the roofs. You know, every penny's going to help, and then figuring out what FEMA's going to do with our claim after our insurance claim is going to be a pretty lengthy process for you also. So I know you're on top of it.
Any further questions or discussion? We'll move forward. The next item on the agenda is also an information item, water tower design. Information regarding the district's communication with the city of Aransas Pass in reference to the new water tower design has been provided to the board. Basically, the city of Aransas Pass Director of Public Works, Fernando Quintanilla, has informed us that a committee has been created for the design and installation of a new water tower. The committee includes members from the Aransas Pass Chamber of Commerce, the Texas Hotel and Lodging Association, and the city. The city is contemplating rebranding and will be considering a new design for a logo. The APISD Panther logo has been provided, and we have requested that this logo be used should the water tower design incorporate Panther or other representative of the school district. So it's just more of an FYI. We did get to vote on which Panther we want on there, and we presented it to that committee. So they will decide ultimately. Moving forward, it was nice of them to even ask us. The next information item is Student Advisory Council meeting. Highlights from the Student Advisory Council's May meeting are included for the board's information, and John Mullinex is actually there and represented them. I don't see a student representative here, so.
I think Nick is one available for a student in my. We discussed the items that they brought up our last meeting, such as the trips to colleges, and we discussed that they're outside of region, and we told them that the principals are made of their concerns and they're addressed with the counselors. The girls' locker room flood had probably been fixed. The announcements and prep classes for SAT, ACT, and TSI. The items have brought the attention of the administrators to discuss with the counselors for how those announcements went out and how they were made for the kids so they had more information about, you know, how to sign up and do that. Requested doors on the new elementary school open inside, and we talked to them about the contractors and the fire codes that we couldn't do that. And then we discussed with them that we talked, you know, Coach Nelson was aware of their concern about them being able to change into and out to out of athletics at AC Blount when they moved up from 6th to 7th grade. And he's aware of that problem and he's supposed to be resolved for them. And suggestion box that they said that they've worked with procedure design and color location, and suggestion boxes have been discussed with Mr. Bennett and Mr. King at both campuses, and they're working with them to try to set up a location and procedures and the forms that they're going to use, and who's going to monitor, and who's going to, they're still working that. So hopefully they'll have that by the start of school next year so they can kick off that next year's suggestion boxes. Some new concerns they have is they wanted to know a better way to disseminate information to the students and parents. Okay. They asked about installing a scrolling message board, something like that, in the cafeteria that all the kids are in there. And that way, there's announcements for dates for certain things, for registration, whatever else. Because it said during announcements in the morning, they make those announcements, but have the kids come here because there's other noise going on in the class or whatever else in the announcements, so, and they're not paying attention. But if they're in the someplace in a central location or by a central office or someplace like that, we could have a scrolling board. That information would be more available to them to look at their leisure and be able to turn them around the clock, so they could, if they missed it during announcement, they could go back there and look at it, so. They want you more use of Twitter and Facebook for announcements, and they also said that, you know, that maybe use them like in the high school gym, the cafeteria where you have the PowerPoint slide. I don't know if you still have that, the PowerPoint slide projected over there. You may, you know, be able to display something up on the screen up during lunch period, so I'm not sure if that same capabilities that the other campuses are not, where they have a PowerPoint projector in the cafeteria, they could do that. But you want some type of announcements presentation, you could have a little slideshow going during lunch, but they could take a look at that too. And that, if that's already there, that'd be a low cost input, you know, as far as that, so they haven't put the storyboards. They also want to know about the capability of starting a campus newspaper to disseminate the information out, and and have a journalism class, and have a journalism class take that over as a project to do a campus newspaper. And we talked to them, like, you know, Mike and I, when we were growing up in school, we had a campus newspaper, and it was by, you know, the kids did it, and they voted up and sold it for 10 cents a copy, and made money out of the paper material to use for it. So it was just, and they also got experience in writing for journalism. They had a whole sheet match like a paper, so they ran it internally. We ran it internally inside the school. And they said that, you know, they thought that would be a good idea. If we did look at something doing that again, we provide more information. We also discussed a little bit about, used to be at the junior high, they had used to have TV sets inside the campuses with that they had donated by a company that had advertisements tied to it, and we've done away with that. But at ODC Blunt, they used to have a camera there that they could tie into that, into their system, and they used to have a newscast every morning that they broadcast out to the kids on the TV set. And therefore, they went over the sports and everything else that they did that. They didn't know if that capability was still available at this campus. It would be something to look at first. You know, the students are doing another newscast and provide that information out to the other kids. And they also just addressed security is still a concern at the campuses, so they like the things that have been done at campuses as far as security, but it's still a concern for them. They just want to make sure that we don't really guard down. And that was it. So it was a very valuable meeting, productive meeting. In fact, I think we only had, out of the kids there, we had one of them that didn't show up, and I think he was absent that day or doing something. So we had almost 100% participation.
I'm impressed with this committee, and what I'm hearing is in general. I have not been able to attend myself, but communication is a number one downfall or a positive aspect of any organization. And these children are saying they need to hear from us more, they need to know. And yes, they're children, you're going to have to tell them 10 times for their. That was the first time they ever heard it, when it finally hits them. So if these things are not unreasonable, they don't sound like they're too much work, I encourage you all to listen to them, and if we can help in any way, let us know, because if this falls on deaf ears, they're going to quit talking to us. And then we're just going to say, we've already brought that up 10 times, no one cares. And again, I know we're all busy, and their perception is their reality.
And so far,
we don't care.
So far, their inputs and what we did in feedback from is the fact that the ideas that they're presenting up at the campus are being listened to by the administrators, and they're taking action on them. So they're very positive as far as they're talking about the organization and what it can do. So they're looking forward to bigger, better things next year. So.
Thank you very much for your work with them. The next action, any questions or information or comments regarding that?
I just want to echo what you said. If we don't take
it, we're going to lose. One more thing. We did ask, and I think we brought this up before, about some written guidance and procedures that we could have set up for the Student Advisory Council. And if we're going to have them on campus, I'm not sure if we need a sponsor for them. If they're going to meet on campus, just have a sponsor, or just have the kids meet by ourselves and bring it to the administrators. You know, we can do that, we set the procedures up and written guidance for them. And that would be a better idea of what, you know, they have more guidance of what they need to do.
We did talk about that the other day. We did set up guidelines on how the students would be selected, but there was no bylaws associated with that. So maybe that's the next step from the school, the advisory committee.
I believe we have a policy where they have to have an advisor.
Is that
right?
Okay.
I I'm almost positive they have to have a teacher representative, okay. Or a district safety and security update. The following updates pertaining to district safety and security have been included in the board's information. The proposal memorandum of understanding with the AP Police Department regarding the district student resource officer, information pertaining to the requirements for the district's police department, updates from the Texas State University Texas School Safety Center, and updates on the status of the revision of the district's emergency operations plan.
Move item number one, which is the MOU. My office, along with police department, for instance, Texas Police Department, been working on the MOU that will satisfy providing safety for our students and staff. We have developed an MOU to two. I want to make this our first reading because I'm before we can make suggestions if any, or at least have an opportunity to. Here's an opportunity to look it over. And at the next board meeting, hopefully we can make an action item to go ahead and approve it. Once it's approved by this board, the chief has said that we will take it to the city council for their approval as well as the community board to meet them together. That's the MOU. The next piece is that we researched APIS, they'd like to start a police department. At one time, it wasn't lit that we had a police department. But according to the state, because of inactivity, we have to go back and reapply. So I don't think it's a long-term process. If that's the direction that the board will go, we will set the rate.
Did the city seem to have any objections to our input to the MRO?
No, we did not. Well, once we got it together, we forwarded to them. They looked over and made suggestions. And Joe went back a couple of times before this version here satisfied both parties. The next one is the SRP from the Texas Safety Center. I think we had a group of administrators go. It was last Tuesday. Some information that came back. We as the administrative staff have decided that it is okay for us to go ahead and adopt the SRP for K-12. We think we all can live with it and implement it effectively, along with continuing to have our drills to make sure that our students are aware of the processes and procedures. These two pages here, one is a poster that we can post inside the hallways of the campuses. And the second one is a plan for reunification after an emergency, giving parents to their students and vice versa. Instead of just having kids text from their phones from the school and say, hey, mom, pick me up, we could have a plan in place and make sure that was working.
One of the concerns that Ms. Johnson had, or one of the requests Ms. Johnson had made previously, was that we look at this in a board workshop along with our administrators to go through it. Just a couple of observations that I saw. There was some verbiage in here concerning if the district adopts this, that they not make any substantial changes to the document. And then also that there's a MOU on the back side that we have to notify, give the name of the group, I Love You Foundation, and we're utilizing it. I believe it'd be beneficial for us as a board to sit down in a workshop and go over it. I know for myself, I get a lot of questions from parents, what are we doing, what's our procedure? I think all of us have an obligation to know exactly what our procedure is so we can communicate it to our staff and citizens or neighbors and ask us. So
we have asked the police department to provide an officer or a sergeant or a captain to provide a training for us. So we can also have to work together. So not only that, but keep them on the same page too.
Right.
So the MOU for I Love You Guys, if I heard correctly from the gentleman in the presentation, is how they get their funding. It's a nonprofit, and that's why he said, you know, yeah, if you want to take it and just use it, you're more than welcome to. But that's how they keep track of the districts, which helps them acquire their funding.
Just by registering.
Yes.
Simply by registering.
So I think the next step for us is to sit down and have that workshop where you guys can get it scheduled. I mean, the other point I'd like to make is I think you guys have met like three times with the chief now, two times.
Yeah.
Two or three times. And we're going to be at the end.
Okay, and number four on that list is update with the emergency plan. You know, we hired Curtis Clay Associates to do the audit, safety audit for the district. I think they did a fantastic job, of course, because of shootings in Florida and other states. They're inundated with audits, and we're not have time to do our plan update. So he is looking at other entities that he's aware of that will do that work for us. And if by chance we don't find anyone, it's going to be one of our summer projects. So we have to do it in-house.
And that's touching base on all the findings of the audit itself?
That is correct.
How often do we do these audits?
Should be done like every 2 or 3 years. We've been updating. I mean, our audits were fine. It's just more of updating the plan. That's been our issue.
Isn't the requirement that we meet certain expectations in a timely manner, or is a second finding or third finding? Is there repeat findings from this audit?
That I'm not aware of. I do have the first, since I've been here, I do have the first audit. And that's when Mr. O'Brien was the Director of Transportation and Maintenance. That was just done probably about 3 years ago. I've been this one, of course. And again, we just need to update it.
Any further discussion? The next item is 2017-2018 Optimal Flexible School Day Program Reports, which is included in our packet.
This is basically the report we do on our OFSD program, kind of let you know where we are and ask for your continued support. We only had 4 students go through it this year, which this is fairly low, but I did talk to Coach Sidell, and she could remember a time when she had 6, so it's not unheard of, but it's just a low number. Now, those 2 of them look like they're on track to get done and take part in graduation. 2 others, we may get through it, but they may not participate in graduation, but hopefully they'll continue on and get done with it. And you see OFSDs there for pregnancy, homelessness, credit recovery, illness, health, life gets in the way. And they come to us, or we suggest maybe OFSD as an option to make sure that they gain credit or get credit or graduate. And we work closely with Mr. O'Brien. He's on that campus and communicate as far as attendance and who's there, who's not there, and what work needs to be done. And once we get y'all's approval, hopefully we can continue with it and get the application in place and send it in. But it is a worthwhile program. We save a couple kids in this year, you know, 2 that probably wouldn't have made it. And we'll probably get the other 2 with some continued effort, but they just may not get it done in time for evaluation. Well,
do we reach out to like the 5 or 6 that were homeschooled?
Reach
for the homeschool.
Oh, as far as a homeschool,
this is an option to you, because
it's usually done before they reach. It's usually done before they reach that point. We don't like to just say, hey, here's OFSDs out there. But if it comes to us and it looks like they fit, then we will offer it up. But it doesn't fit every situation.
Is there a number that requires to have that program every year to continue the program? Every year we have to go back to them and ask them to continue it, right? To approve it.
We send in our information along with our setup, who's involved with the decision-making process, and the general summary of the program, and it's up to them to allow us to continue.
There's no set number like
that? Not to my knowledge. I didn't send any of that.
Wayne, if you don't mind, explain the subject, because I've heard the program. How is it systemically done at the DAP campus? So this isn't the class, the recovery class that Terry said it has on campus. This is at DAP.
This is in addition.
So they come in at their own time, and is it
at their own time? Ours, the way we do it, they come in their own time during the school week. I mean, you can set them up for, you know, in the evenings or whatever works. But, and we have offered that if we thought we needed it. But this year, these 4 kids are during the school day, and They got to be there a minimum of 45 minutes on any day they show up for us to get any credit. And all, he keeps close tabs on the numbers and reports to us every day on attendance and try to stay with their absence a couple of days. Mr. O'Brien's on the phone.
He has a lot. Calling every week.
Documented.
There's no requirement to have a team. Or is there a requirement?
We have to let them know that we do have teachers there, certified teachers, and a principal on campus. And who's involved, the counselor's involved with the process, overall process.
So the teacher that's running the DAP placement is also the teacher that's available to them, for them on that part of the instruction program?
What we have is I have a teacher that's really primarily responsible for our AEP program, which is the non-disciplinary side, and she does the OFSD program as well.
Who is that teacher on staff that does that?
Her name is Irisina Sandoval.
And since it's on Edgenuity, they can work on it at home.
Yes,
as well.
And some of them do. One of the ones that we're trying to, and so, believe me, it's like pulling teeth sometimes. And we're trying to get them through. One of them that's trying to get finished. Of those two that aren't going to finish by graduation, she is doing some work at home now.
And the computer just tracks that time for you.
So
you can prove that she's been online and doing it. Yeah. So
they get better when you log in the computer, you get those minutes.
Oh, yeah. It keeps up with everything when they log on, how long they stay on, yeah. Whether there was any activity.
Is there a minimum amount that each kid has to participate in per week or per month or per year to maintain qualified? So if a kid only comes 45 minutes a week, that's
we,
not
we
enough.
Tell them 4 hours a week,
yeah.
But it's really only 45 minutes a week.
And any time they come in, they have to be there a minimum 45 minutes before you can get any funding from being there at all. So.
Right, and that's primarily for the ADA, but we say you come in as much as you can to get in here, and if I have to go, and I've done this, I've had to go find a way to get you up here, I'll do it. I mean, it's a great recovery program.
School is an obstacle for these kids, not a...
Right. But we still recommend that they find a schedule.
Gets in their way.
And try to go.
And we do, like you said, we've offered after school evenings, Saturdays. They schedule it on Saturdays, we'll do it. Or even, we've actually had one, I don't know if I just said it, we did one Sunday this year, but we're doing it. If they come up, we're going to do it.
Good. Well, thank y'all for your dedication.
Is Ms. Sandoval a certified teacher? Is she an AEP?
She's a certified teacher.
Is it a requirement of the state for us to have a certified teacher in there?
We do have to have.
I believe so, yes, sir.
Okay, this is an information item. We're not here to approve anything. Is this deemed to be approved for continuation,
please? It's continued support, but we've always, in the past, just kind of gave it your blessing, I think, and we move forward.
Our policies? Is it required for us to approve?
I don't think so.
No. We can't approve it. It's not on the agenda for such, but you definitely have our blessing, and he'll just double check with the policy if it needs to circle back around. Then we'll have to put it on the next agenda. Sorry.
I would appreciate your support.
Absolutely. We'll make sure that gets to the next agenda.
Okay. Just for the record, I think it was an information issue last year. The presentation was just to say how many students participated in graduating in college successive programs.
We haven't approved next year's program, correct?
I would like clarification whether it's board policy, and I want somebody to look it up and tell me the policy if it's a policy that applies or if it doesn't.
We have not. Any further discussion? The next item is also information for the overview of the STAR results. She's already here.
Yes, I'm here. We're ready to go.
Yes.
What you have is basically our first round of testing. So 5th and 8th grade results from April. And what we're looking at right now is the summary report. The first page is the 5th grade reading. If you look across the top line, you will see how many students tested, what the average skill score was, and then you see the number and percent for each category did not meet, approaches, meets, and masters. Did not meet means they did not pass the test. Approaches means that they passed the test. Meets means that they did well enough to be what is considered college readiness on the test. And then masters is they did excellent. So So those are our percentages under those categories for fifth grade reading on first page. Underneath all of that, you will see our different subpopulations. One thing that you'll notice is that we don't seem to have a lot of gaps in our data for our different subgroups. We're pretty consistent throughout our subgroups. And then another thing that you'll notice is our economically disadvantaged, because we're 100% economically disadvantaged, those numbers are going to equal to that total every time. Because of Harvey, we were declared 100% economically disadvantaged. So we could get all of us could get free lunch, all the students.
Why is there a different designation between approaches and meets? Why does the state do that? What's the rationale?
When they changed to the STAR test, they had this crazy phase-in plan that they were going to phase in over 12 years. The passing level standard and at one of the last, not the last legislative session, but when they put this in, they got rid of that phase-in standard and just decided to go with something that was easier for everybody to understand. The approaches level is anywhere between 40 to 60% of the tests that the students pass in order to reach that standard. So the word approaches is probably not the best term to use there, but those students are close to grade level, and with some remediation, they will get to grade level to pass that test, and so that's considered a passing standard for our accountability system.
I have one question for you. I'm going to keep percentage-wise. You showed did not meet 13% and for all students, and approach is 68%,
yes.
And then the meets is 34%.
Mm-hmm.
And then the master's at 14%, and that's more than 100% if you add those up. So the 68%
includes meets
the other
and masters.
Two as well?
Yes, it does.
So it includes the meets and masters as well?
And then the meets includes the masters.
And do we know how those scores compare with the rest of the state scores?
The state scores just came out Friday. So I don't have those in your packet for you. In fact, I don't have it in front of me right now, but those just came out at the end of the day on Friday.
Yeah. Can we get those sent to us, Mr. Camp, someday, you know, so we have an idea of how we're doing against the rest of the state?
Something on the website?
It is on the state website. Behind the reading, you'll see the math as well. You've probably already been looking at how we did fifth grade math. 31%, 69%, 36%, and 15%. Our eighth grade reading is behind that.
Now, am I correct? This fifth grade class is the fourth grade class that shined last year, right? Math, aren't they?
We did receive distinction.
We received distinction, but part of that is also regarding the growth projection measure, because not only do we get credit for them passing, a student could fail but show growth. And so you can score, you can pass the test and show no growth, you can fail the test and show a growth of one or a growth of two. The distinctions that this fifth grade class earned as fourth graders, I'm not 100% certain, but I think the distinction were based on closing gaps, which was growth projection measure versus passing standard.
And this test doesn't have any no consideration for growth this year.
There is a growth projection measure for this year also. That information is not. This was just preliminary passing.
I do have
second administration.
Something else I was going to show you
that addresses that. So in your opinion, are we in alignment pretty close to their performance from last year?
Yes.
Comparing them?
Thank you. And I'll explain this to you.
Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. So on this report, this compares us to last year. In those categories, you'll see 2017 and 2018 for fifth grade reading and math at the top. And then you'll see our trend, whether we just went up or down. I just did a simple up or down, up being with green, and of course down being with orange. So we were pretty close. We actually saw a lot of green, which is a good thing, considering the year that we've had. And then you can see eighth grade as well, a lot of green. And then on the bottom, what you see are the cohort groups. So from fourth grade to fifth grade, from seventh grade to eighth grade, and how they did in reading and math.
This one's much easier to read than
some. I think so too. And also, these students have received remediation. They're taking their test this week. The retest, the ones that did not pass this, are doing that this week. Yesterday and today.
Mm-hmm. Are we doing the third time?
We are not going to participate in the third round of testing in the summer.
That relates to this.
Yes. Yes.
That was released to us by the TA back in December.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Yes.
So the state is telling us they're leaving that at our discretion of whether we want them. If they fail the second time, the state's leaving it to our discretion of whether we want to take it the third time. Correct?
Correct.
And we're choosing not to?
We are choosing not to.
And what's the rationale for that?
One of the rationales for that is something I'm going to talk about in a minute, which is our summer school program that we're going to be doing. The other was just because of the year that we've had with our students. And going through the third round of testing, we just didn't want to put our students through that.
So, at the end of the day, when you get to the end of the process and you have a student that hasn't passed the second assessment, as a district, what are we going to do collaboratively or systematically to determine whether we're going to keep them back a year, retain them, or whether we're going to move them forward?
We have our grade placement committees that meet and decide that. And they do that every year anyway, and we will still do that for this year. So they'll meet and decide what happens to those students, whether they stay back, whether they move on. Students who don't pass the eighth grade, they are put in special classes at the high school. So they do receive remediation once they get there also. So they get extra help there.
Okay, so on the release from RPA, it says grade placement committee, June retest requirements waived. I've engaged in numerous conversations with district leaders, parents, and teachers to determine whether adjustments should be made to this year related to student success initiative, grade advancement requirements, or STAR. Due to the impact of Hurricane Harvey, I'm waiving the requirement of the creation of a grade placement committee. So the state's waived the requirement that the district is going to continue it to determine whether to keep them or not?
They will still meet on those kids.
So what's the rationale for us keeping it in the state later? I understand you have to have some type of determination of how we're going to move it forward.
Yes.
You think the placement is more accurate than the STAR?
Most of the time, when the test does not determine whether the student moves on or not. Most of the time we've already determined that. If they were going to be retained, then we've already been through our process and have determined that. But really that placement committee is just to make sure that we're meeting that student's needs once they move to the next level or stay retained.
41% math, eighth grade is a high percent to move on or to not. I know this isn't the final number, but this comes in same amount. We're moving a lot of children on. I'm just going to assume we're not going to hold the majority of them back.
Correct. And usually we have quite a few more paths on the second round of the administration.
Not being in the education field, what is the deterrent of keeping them back? I mean, surely there's arguments to say, well, it's in their best interest to hold them back because they've learned the material that they need for the next year. And then there's an argument that says, well, we can remediate them. the following year, once we identify them, we have pull-out programs, we have after-school programs, but I'm not an educator.
We don't have large percentages of retentions here. I know some districts that have much larger percentages. Most of the research says that it does not make a positive difference for those students at all.
That is one of the 13 criteria to be placed on the at-risk list, according to the state, and they range from incarceration to pregnancy to failing the STAR test and then not passing it the next year with 10% growth. But once a child is retained, they're placed on the at-risk list and they do not come off for the duration of their, you can be retained in first grade and you are on the at-risk list for the rest of your educational career. Doesn't necessarily mean that being labeled at risk is a horrible thing, but you know, I always interpret that as campus principal is a pretty powerful statement that says, if the state doesn't ever let you come off because you've been retained, then there's a pretty good deciding.
Right. You know, no, you headed, yeah, that makes sense. And I guess going back to Ms. Piazza's argument concerning the number of kids is, if we promote them on and they're identified at risk, then I guess the next step, if they're in an IEP, has to be written up.
But that's where the, like the RTI, or the response to intervention process of tier 1, 2, 3, and if they get all the way through the tier 3, that's when special ed referrals and special ed placements and the IEP begin. But you can have the tier 1, 2, 3 intervention is where you're supposed to be working to close those gaps and meet those needs. I know that the students that, now the beginning of this year was a little bit rough, but the students that fail, say the fourth graders, if they are placed in fifth grade for next year based on a grade placement committee decision, then they will automatically be assigned to a tier 3 intervention, which is something I'm trying to get started.
I know you haven't touched it, but this summer program, does it go with up to eighth grade?
It goes up to fifth grade.
So these guys, maybe these eighth graders are not going to be affected or benefit from your program?
Correct. You also have information in your packet on the summer programs. We received a grant from Save the Children organization, and it was part of Harvey Recovery because we did have students that missed so much school, and we had students that need a little extra help due to that missed instruction. This grant is for their summer boost program, and you have the information on the summer boost program. It includes literacy, math, STEM education, nutrition. There's an enrichment piece and a community service piece to it also. And they also are going to include their Journey of Hope program, which is their psychosocial piece. We are in the process of developing student recruitment lists for this, so we've asked for input from the schools on which students need to be at the Summer Boost. We have received most of our training materials. I have recruited teachers, and we are about to begin the training on this program. We're going to hold it at Charlie Marshall. These students will get free breakfast, free lunch, they'll get transportation. We're getting some field trips in line for some Fridays, so it's going to be a really, really excellent summer school. I wish it did go up to eighth grade, but it doesn't. It only goes up to fifth grade.
How many students are you?
We're targeting 150, trying to get as many as we can for the number of teachers that we have.
And this is a grant?
This is a grant from Save the Children. It's going to be somewhere between $80,000 and $100,000 worth of everything that they're giving us.
Any questions?
No, thanks, very comments.
Thank you for taking this on.
You're welcome.
The district.
You're welcome. We also have our ESL summer school. We have that each year. We have your information on that is required. We have our teacher, and they will be housed with the Summer Boost students. Their dates will be a little different, but the times will be the same so that we can align transportation and meals and such.
And that's just advertised through the teachers and the parent?
Yes.
Interactions?
Yes, they sit at home. It's for kinder, incoming kinder and first grade students.
Again, how many do you project using that?
That, last year we had, I think, 14. This year we don't have that many signed up yet. We're trying to get more. We also will have our high school STAR credit recovery summer programs going on as well.
All at Charlie Marshall?
No, those will be at the high school.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Comments? The next item is an action item. Information regarding the bid for South Plains Contracting for the demolition of the district facilities has been provided to the board. Recommendation is to award the contract for the demolition project to the recommended contractor as provided by administration.
Before you have the proposal tabulation of all the companies who have bid for the demolition projects, we have them bid separately for all five items. South Plains demolition came in at $139,000. We believe they will be the best bet. Best thing for the tower, basically. Also, they sent over a reference list. This is on the very next page. Some of the projects they have done around the area.
And again, we're comparing apples to apples when we would get these quotes.
That's correct.
There's a $183,000 difference between the top and the bottom.
That's correct.
$54,000 between the next closest one. So permits for asbestos abatement, all of that is all included in here. There's no hidden fees that we have to.
I'll let Todd, if you want to stand up, because he wrote the specs. He wrote the specs for the. I may not have anything to say, but.
All of these had the same information and.
Yes, ma'am. Demo contractors are a different bunch, and. We had six bids, I think, and so they all had the same spec book with the asbestos survey or asbestos work remediation. They all had bonds. They all had all the requirements. So,
is there any penalties if they exceed the amount of completion dates?
You can try to go after them, but
is that in our proposal?
There's a date. They have a number of days that they're going to finish in. I mean, if they don't finish in those days, it's going to cost them all money every day they don't. So, but you've got to show a damage that you have incurred if they don't, you know. I mean, if they go 61 days and they say 60, it's going to be difficult to collect for one day. But, I mean, you had them work on one of your projects here before, so they've done, they tore down the old Pampa Den, or he did, that company did about 15 years ago and maybe more, so. I mean, it was competitive bid, so it wasn't a proposal, so we didn't evaluate them. It's a low bid. That's what you got.
We've been talking about huge dollar amounts.
I know.
Every time you turn around, this one's $139,000. I think the saving grace on this is on the previous report from the update on the hurricane. There's some buildings that we're not going to. Repair. So our estimated cash value of the insurance company on all those projects, which is the technology department, the portable buildings, and the homemaking cottage, and I'm afraid that this cash value of demolition of the buildings, the insurance company is going to reimburse us $157,000. So it basically pays for this demolition for the district. It's not going to really cost us get rid of some eyesores that have been around forever.
Absolutely.
If there's not any questions, I'll make a motion that you approve the contractor for the demolition, South Plains Demolition.
Any opposed? All approved?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries with Victor Galvan making the proposal and Patricia Brandt second it. Motion carries. The next item is an action item. The key card system options at the new elementary school. Information regarding these options for funding of the electronic key card system at the new elementary school has been provided. The recommendation is to be select an option for the key card entry for the new elementary school. There are four different proposals.
Yes, we have some options there. And I'll just briefly go over the options with you. Key card system is estimated to be about $70,000. We can go all metal keys with an additional cost of the district. Or we do have about $60,000 in contingency monies for change orders. We may add $10,000 to the kit. But essence, that we're not losing any money in the contingency fund for change orders down the line. Or option number three, we could possibly modify our roofing system. Cadillac roof down to perhaps a Chevy Impala. Still good as far as 20 years of warranty, but we could have a saving of approximately $150,000, to which you take that $70,000 from it, and that still leaves us about 80 grand to furnish the elementary school, perhaps with some new technology and furniture along those lines. Or, and again, this is not a closed list, so it's just things that came off the top of my head. Or we just can go ahead and take the pool from the bond money because we need to designate some bond money for safety and security. So those are four options. There needs to be some other options out there. You may even have options yourself, but that's just at the time of the on how we can focus the project.
I just had one comment. I'll come back to look through some notes. I don't recall where that was cut out of the project. Did we ever find the minutes?
Didn't find the minutes. We did have a board workshop the week of the 12th. It might have been on the 12th, which is that June 12th meeting. Perhaps a closed session, I think, at the time. Someone came in as we went over this. Actually, was trying to cut dollars from the original overview associated with Cooper. There was a few items that were taken out. Access system was.
You believe that was at the June meeting?
I believe so. I want to say the June 12th.
Todd, do you have a comment on the Cadillac versus Impala roof? What are we losing there as far as quality or look-wise? Or
if you remember on the sports complex, we did the same thing. So we took the same spec from the, we saved quite a bit of money on the sports complex. We changed the roof to this roof here that we're saying as an option. So it's your basic difference is the cap sheet, the very top sheet. Pretty much everything else is exactly the same. So you still have a 20-year dollar limit. I'm just, GAF roof is, and we have Garland roof spec. And so Garland has better service, you know, I mean, they're a better service company, but you're paying quite a bit for that service and that, you know, that type of, pretty much similar, it's similar roof. You know, it's the same type of roof, modified roof, same warranty. The only difference is you're just paying for that extra service.
Extra service.
Well, when they'll come out, you know, if you've got a problem, they'll come out quicker, probably. I mean, the first 2 years, the general contractor covers it with the roofing company that actually installs it. After the 18 years, you've got to call the manufacturer. And so that manufacturer may or may not have a representative in this area, but, you know, they eventually have to come down and look at it. But Garland has a lot of local representatives, so they come a lot quicker, you know, basically, and take care of problems.
That's what makes it the Cadillac version.
That's pretty much, and, you know, there are so many different roof systems as far as they do all kinds of testing. The bottom line is you know, it's the 20-year warranty is what you want, no dollar limit, and that's what you have for both products. One is have better service, maybe the cap sheet's a little bit better. But, I mean, it's your decision to
Do our insurance premiums require us to have a certain standard?
No. It still meets all the TDI windstorm. I mean, it's exactly the same, other than manufacturer's different. Maybe the roof's a little more tear resistant, that, you know, that.
Cosmetically, does it look different?
No, not really. No, I mean, they're white roofs. They have white granules on them. So, I mean, it's, no, not really. I don't think you'd notice, you'd tell from one to the other. So, I mean, that's just an option. We wanted to put it out there because we did take advantage of it at the gym because, you know, we were over budget there, so.
Okay. Any questions? This is an action item.
I have any questions, just some observations. I don't, just my personal opinion, I don't believe we need to go to the metal keys. I think we've addressed those issues that we had at the high school by getting a standardized key set there. We're building something from the ground up in light of all the changes that we've had, security issues that we've had. I think we'd be shortchanging ourselves by not keeping the remote system. I visited with the chief earlier today, and from their standpoint, if they do have a situation where they have to come, it's going to be a lot easier for them just to scan the card and get in their building versus getting the key and trying to find the right key and open the door. I think if, God forbid, that happens and we're able to get in there 2 seconds earlier and save a life, it's definitely worth the $70,000 that we're looking at. As far as which route we go, I mean, that's more prerogative. I don't quite understand the $150,000 Cadillac for service. I don't even know why that was, the upgraded roof was on there. We could have saved $150,000 and on the other route. Considering all the different things that have happened through the scope, I mean, I think we need a contingency fee for down the road. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it's not in our best interest to expend all that right now. We'd be back in another meeting and they'd be right in front of us saying, hey, we need another $30,000 for whatever.
Is there
that doesn't make sense to me either.
How many doors are going to have the key access? We're still going to just, you know, the electronic key. Some of them are going to be just a metal key anyhow, right?
Well, on the exterior, almost every door is going to have a key. Every door that gets into the school, we have a mechanical room and a fire riser room that you can't get into the school. It's a room on the exterior of the building. Those are the only two rooms that wouldn't be access controlled. All the other doors would have access control. All the entry doors. And there's three components. It's hardware, hardware is already there. The access control hardware is already in the base bid. So you've got electronic hardware. What you're missing is the software and hardware. That's the access control system. And then the power is already there too. So if you wanted to add it another time, you could do that. But obviously it'd be better to do it now, but.
So let me throw you a curveball. In visiting with the chief in some of their facilities, they're gonna partner up with a company that's a non-profit company that goes through a foundation, and they're able to pass through more of a more cost of the system versus going out and getting a retail. If we decide to do the system, is there anything that prohibits us from partnering with that company and saving some money to install the system that they have?
I don't believe so, but we would it would have to happen pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, because there has to be an integration between the hardware and the network and the power to make sure we get it all. Everything talks, and the frames have to be prepped a certain way. I think we're still going to do due diligence and look at other companies. You know, not just at this point. We need to look at everybody.
So if we got that information to you guys could vet it for us and see if it's something that we could save some money on, and whether it's practical or not.
Okay. Like Todd said, though, I mean, that contract is never written, so we don't have a certain person that we have to go with for the access control, so we can always look at it and see if there's a better route or if there's a better number. That number that he's giving you is what we turned to you on bid day, which was an alternate that was not accepted. So, I mean, it's also been... How long since the bid day? It's in a year, so I mean, that number could go up, it could go down. That's a fluctuation number that was plugged in a year ago, so.
I understand.
That can't be a hard number that we go off of. I mean, hopefully it's gonna be, you know, significantly amount lower, but we cannot tell you at that moment.
Just for your information, the number he threw around was like $900 a door.
Yeah.
Your take, that's about right. Even the hall mill frames alone are up there at that price or even more.
So what this does, I don't think you have access control anywhere else in the school district. And when you put it in this school district, it kind of sets a precedent what you do to the rest of the school district, because the software is one of the most expensive part that you have to buy in the software. And you pretty much want the same software in all your school districts. So once you set that one, that's why I think it's very important to meet with that access control person and make sure you get the right system. And that's what I think we ought to do.
Well, I've been an advocate for this security safety since I got on this board, so I think the key access is just state of the art, need to be absolute necessity. And I don't know that we need a Cadillac roof, so we do need to make a proposal and whether, I don't know where we're at. We got four options, so this is kind of an odd way to do the presentation.
I'll make a motion that we modify the roofing system to incorporate, how we put, kind of roofing system, do you call it?
Modified roof.
A modified roof system.
Here's chain of manufacturers is all we're doing. I mean, like you said, I mean, there's really no difference in the caps. If there is, it's very small. I mean, we'd never know. And all in our, looking at it through our eyes, I mean, but it's just chain of manufacturers.
I can make a motion we modify the roofing system and also approve the key card entry system for the new elementary school.
Second. Any opposed? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. And it be shown that Victor Galvan approved the changing of roof to a modified version, along with approving the key card entry system for the new elementary, and was seconded by Patricia Branch. Motion carries. Thank you, Todd. Very much. Thank you.
And don't spend the extra $80,000.
No. Okay, the next one is an action item also. The rebid for the concessions and restrooms. A proposal tabulation and the revised bid for Gorling Contracting for the concession restroom building are included in the board's information. They recommend we approve the request to rebid the concession restroom budget.
Again, looking at the proposal tabulation, the bid from Burley came in, well, all three bids came in overbid. And remember, we only set aside $400,000 for the concession. This is, you know, considerably large amount past that $400,000. Again, if the board's option is just that, because we can't get those bids down, you know, remember this is a metal building, we just think that the amount is too large, and perhaps, I know it's you know, a little distance after the hurricane, but perhaps there's another company out there who may come in and go to war with these three companies have.
So is your recommendation to go back for rebids?
That is my recommendation. Now, of course, there's always a chance that the bids can still come in, you know, over. And we may be looking at a larger amount. I hope that's not the case, but for 1,400 square feet, some restroom, $500,000, I think is kind of pricey. But again,
so, Mr. Kim, on your recommendation, would that be you go back to the original specs?
We'll go back to the original specs to include the concrete, the sidewalks that will have to come from the stadium side down to the concession. As a matter of fact, we can go ahead and look at the individual concession stands again and see if we get a different price.
leave every option on the table, but again, I want to make sure that we're spending our dollars wisely, and yes, it's bond money, but good voters voting in, and we should make good use of it.
One of the notes they have here is that the painting on the unexposed metal building was not included, so we're gonna go back to the original spec and go to the metal building, or we're gonna go?
Well, if the original spec was cinder block, I believe it was, concrete, I'm saying, if cinder block is coming in too expensive, this is sculptural metal building. If you can recall our visitation to Edna, one of their football games, they had a metal building, and it was done quite well. So again, we're just trying to get the most bang for the buck, and we think that the metal building would maybe be a little bit cheaper than cinder block or concrete.
And Rockport has one like that, really.
But again, just keep in mind, there's always that option to where, you know, it comes in higher than what we even anticipated. Tyler, do you have any comment or?
Well, what we did is we went back and forth with Gerby, and we gave him, you know, different specs, different designs, and we got down pretty close to 440-something, you know, as a name of the board meeting, 450. And then but going on the opposite end of the field, we ran into a possible situation of getting the power out there. That was a question that y'all had, and an additional cost for the sidewalks. And so we got additional cost for just the sidewalks was almost $70,000. I thought that was over $8 a square foot. I thought that was kind of high. So I thought, well, it may be best to rebid it to get it down to a more reasonable square foot cost. And so we've got all these options already drawn. I said, well, let's just rebid it. And we could do like we did on the demo, bid it concrete block. We could do metal building. You know, we could break it out so you have, you know, try to take advantage of the best option. And so that's where we're at.
Are you familiar with what Flower Bluff has done at their facilities?
No.
Look, it's not block and it's not a metal building. I'm not too sure what material they used on it. And it's kind of a two-story complex. Haven't been there, I just saw it on TV. I was wondering what something like that would cost.
I can go look at it. I mean, it might be hardy board or something like that.
Right.
Cement board. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing.
Maybe worthwhile.
Yeah. I mean, I've done one like that. But it's just the plumbing costs a lot, and you know, where we got to take the drainage, I mean, that's is a big cost factor.
In the original conversations that we had, if we were going to move it, I guess to the south side of the state, what were we going to do with the old building? What were we going to do with the
losses? We were going to maintain the storage. Then when the tennis courts had tournaments, whatever they could use, the restaurant, we store some track stuff.
So the reference here to delete demolition of all existing structure and apparatus has to do with the maintenance building.
I am recommending the dark color, of course, it's your the current high school facade.
I make the motion to approve A, first one.
Let's identify this A as being the darker one to the left of the picture as you look at it. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Let it be shown that David Richter sent the motion and Patricia Branch seconded, and motion carries. This time is set aside for any board member to address any topics for future meetings. Discuss any old business should be listed as a separate item on the agenda in order to comply with the Open Meetings Act. This is allows any interested person or party to be acknowledged in any content.
I just want to say congratulations to Keyburger for 100% attendance on the third grade star test today. That's a good thing.
I think we discussed that we wanted to set up a safety schedule and workshop in your future with the Chief Blanchard for administration and board.
We'll try to have that before next board meeting. We'll be checking in more schedules.
I'd request we review our facility use and policy.
Sections 551.074, 551.071, 551.082, 552.0821, 551.083, and 551.029. At this time, we will convene to executive session.
The resignations and the employees and also the retirees. I make a motion we accept the resignations and retirees that have been applied.
Second. Any opposed? All in favor?
Aye.
And it is shown that the board has accepted the resignations from the employees and the retirees. And approved by Mr. Molinax and seconded by Mrs. Branch, and it is 9:41.